Okay, good morning. So today we will have 2 hours of lectures on combustion. So before we start on combustion, I mean this is some subject which is slightly peripheral to thermodynamics. It will be used mostly when you are doing applied courses like power plant engineering or IC engines, but there are a few concepts that probably need to be reiterated. I mean many of the concepts are related to chemical reactions, and there is of course the concept of adiabatic flame temperature which must be told, and if this is known and a reasonable knowledge is given, I think it will be very useful in the future courses where power plant engineering or IC engines is taught. So before we begin combustion, let's see what fuels we normally encounter, and we'll realize, I mean I won't spend too much time on fuels, okay. So as engineers or as mechanical engineers, we will encounter solid, liquid and gaseous fuels. So the solid fuels are mostly used in external type of combustion engines. So this would be, you know, most of the plants which are run on Rankine cycle, they would use for example coal as the main fuel. Of course there are a lot of plants nowadays which use biomass and garbage, but coal is the most standard fuel that we use in our power plants. And maybe you know some background students already have, you know, that coal is formed due to high pressure on plants and animals which have been buried for long, and there are various forms of coal which are, you know, in the formation region like peat or lignite. And lignite is a reasonably well formed coal that is used often, and the most common coal that we use in Indian power plants is bituminous coal. One thing you can emphasize is that Indian coal is actually has a lot of big percentage of ash, and the better coals are what are called as anthracites, but these are mostly used for metallurgical processes where pure coal is required. Otherwise in power plants we normally go for bituminous coal. Okay, so if we come to liquids, okay, you all know that crude oil is obtained from various oil fields, and this crude oil is later refined and undergoes a process called fractional distillation. At different temperatures, different fractions will liquefy out, and finally whatever remains in the gaseous form will probably be there at in gaseous form at room temperature. And you know that most of the fuels that we encounter are going to be hydrocarbon. So coal is more or less purely carbon with some ash and other things, but most of the liquid and gaseous fuels are purely hydrocarbon. And anything with more than C5 is usually would be and above would be in liquid form. So for example, you know, what is normally called as gasoline or petrol, okay, the most common compound which is associated with gasoline is isooctane, but in general petrol consists of everything between around C5 to C9, a huge range, and isooctane is one of the biggest components that you can think goes in there. However, it's just a mixture of many compounds. If you go slightly higher towards C10, you get what is called as kerosene or sold as kerosene. And if you go slightly higher towards C12, you get what is called as diesel. And if you go even higher, you know, the liquid starts becoming thicker, and these are then no longer used in IC engines and used in furnaces, and you get what is called as furnace oil, you know, close to C20. And beyond this, if the hydrocarbon has per molecule more than 20 carbon atoms, the thing starts becoming stickier and thicker. And you know, at very high carbon content, C60 and all, you will get what is called a tar. So these are the things that we obtain from crude oil, and you know, most of these are used in either IC engines or power plants. So this probably needs to be told. And finally, we have gases. So you know, anything below C5 would be a gas. So for example, you know, butane and propane, okay, these are gases that remain after fractional distillation, and butane and propane together are liquefied and sold as LPG, that is liquefied petroleum gas. It is a combination of butane and propane and maybe some ethane in there. And when we come to methane, it is mostly sold as natural gas. That is because in most marshes, etc., you know, the gas which comes out naturally after fermentation is methane, and hence by default methane is called as natural gas. So whatever is sold as natural gas is actually around 90% methane, and the remaining could be ethane and butane and so on. So, and natural gas is used in CNG engines, etc. So this is roughly how the fuels would be, and of course, I think once this background is given regarding fuels, we can come to the combustion of these fuels. And I think here you must remind students that, you know, mostly it's finally a chemical reaction, okay, and they have learned chemical reactions in 11th and 12th standard, and the first thing that we can probably tell is balancing of reactions. So the simplest species to take normally, and that is what we would start with, is start with methane. Okay, methane is CH4. Okay, we require some amount of O2. Let me not put how much, and I will get CO2 plus H2O. So this is when you can tell them to start balancing this reaction. There is, they know what balancing means, and basically every element on the right hand side and left hand side has to be balanced. And the reason is that we are not looking at nuclear reactions where atoms of one element will transmute into atoms of other elements. So every element, the atom should be balanced on either side. So the carbon is one on the left side, it's one on the right side, so that's pretty good. Hydrogen, you know, there are four on the left side, two on the right side, so if I just add two here, it will be four. Now if I look at oxygen, CO2 consists of one O2, and twice H2O will have another two O's. So totally I require four O's on the left side, so I will just put here two. So this is the simplest balancing that I could think of, but here you must now tell that, you know, whenever we burn fuel, you know, we require some oxidant, and we have just put oxygen here. And of course, it must be emphasized that fuels need not be only hydrocarbon. I mean, rocket fuels don't consist of hydrocarbon, and oxidants need not be purely oxygen. I mean, they can consist of other elements, but as far as we are concerned, we look primarily at hydrocarbons and oxygen, because this is what is used in all the heat engines that we operate, and this is what is more important for us as mechanical engineers. So oxygen is not just available directly, but it is available only in the form along with nitrogen in air, and air is the most common oxygen that we will always use. So at this point you must emphasize that all our calculations, okay, for IC engines, power plant, etc., will involve the presence of nitrogen, and it is very important to account for this nitrogen because it affects the net temperature of whatever we are using. And at this point you can say, see, all these are on a molar basis here, because I am saying 1 CH4 means 1 mole of CH4, twice O2 would mean 2 moles of O2, 1 CO2 would mean 1 mole of CO2, 2 H2O would mean 2 moles of H2O. So in the atmosphere, you know, by volume there is around 21% oxygen and remaining 79% of nitrogen. So moles and volume correspond to each other because equal number of moles occupy equal volume irrespective of the species. So that means for 1 mole of oxygen there are 79 upon 21 moles of N2, which roughly turns out to be 3.76 moles of nitrogen. So hence what you must emphasize is that this reaction, though is not, was initially written only as a balanced chemical reaction, as far as we are concerned it must be written as such: CH4 plus twice O2 plus twice into 3.76 N2 gives CO2 plus twice H2O. The nitrogen does not take part in any reaction, and I will just write it as twice into 3.76 N2. So on both sides I have added nitrogen and it is remaining unburned. Of course, you will realize that when we talk of very high temperatures, we may have to account for dissociation of nitrogen or nitrogen reacting with oxygen, but we will keep it simple now and say that nitrogen does not react, and we will add it on both sides, and we will see that this is especially needed, the nitrogen, in calculating stoichiometric air fuel ratios and also the adiabatic flame temperature. So this is what we write. So balanced reaction, we have balanced every atom of an element on either side. So you also realize that if the same number of atoms of an element are on both sides, okay, the atoms are not going to lose any mass. So the mass on the left and right side will also balance out. So there is also a mass balance. Okay. Again, this is not a nuclear reaction. In a nuclear reaction, you would have lost mass and you would have gained energy due to the loss of mass. Here you do not gain energy because of loss of mass, but purely chemical reaction. So there is mass balance and mass on either side is the same. Now you must emphasize that this does not mean that moles will balance. So moles do not balance or need not balance, I should say. In some cases they will. So for example, in the reaction that we have just written here, okay, on the left side there is 1 mole of CH4 plus 2 moles of oxygen and plus 7.52 moles of nitrogen. So this makes it 9.52 moles on the reactant side. If I look at the right side, I see that there is 1 mole of CO2, twice 2 moles of H2O, and still 7.52 moles of nitrogen, and I have 9.52 moles on the product side also. But if I choose a different species, so for example, I can choose heptane. So heptane is C7H16. So I will just write oxygen plus nitrogen giving. So you will see that I will get 7 CO2 plus 8 H2O. So I require 7 of O2 here and 4 of O2 here. So I will have 11 O2 here, which means this will be 11 times 3.76, which means I will have 11 multiplied by 3.76 N2. So if you see the left side, the reactants, you will realize that there is 1 plus 11 plus 11 multiplied by 3.76. I will not do this multiplication, it is just 12 plus 11 multiplied by 3.76, and products, there is 7 plus 8, 15 plus 11 multiplied by 3.76. So you see that product side, there is 3 moles extra, because this is only 12 plus 11 multiplied by 3.76, whereas this is 15. So the number of moles will not balance, that is because atoms of different elements combine and form bigger or smaller species. In this case, heptane was a very big species, and that was just 1 mole of heptane, but we found far more moles of carbon dioxide and water, and hence the moles do not balance. But of course, you will see that atoms of every element have to balance and the mass has to balance. So as long as this is told, I think we can proceed further. What we would do next is that you emphasize the fact that we will always be using 3.76 as a factor for nitrogen, and this is something that they must remember now, that 1 mole O2 corresponds to 3.76 moles of N2 in air. This is assuming air is being used. Okay, and which is what we will always be using, and which means that 1 mole of oxygen corresponds to 4.76 moles of air, because air is composed of those 3.76 moles of nitrogen plus the 1 mole of oxygen. So for every mole of oxygen, there is 4.76 moles of air. So this is something that probably needs to be emphasized. This is a number that is people expect that you would often remember, as far as mechanical engineers are concerned, whenever we are going to use air, the 3.76 is a number that we often remember. So once this is done, what we can next go to is again a concept which is known to students, which is what is called as an endothermic and exothermic reaction. So basically, if there is a reaction A plus B giving C plus D, and if A plus B is at some standard state, and again you can emphasize, and we will keep on emphasizing, that first we will define something called as a standard state, and the standard state will always be 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C or 298 Kelvin. So let us say A and B are at standard state, okay, and they react and form C and D, and C and D are brought back to standard state. You will realize that to carry out the reaction, at least some energy was required, or some energy is liberated. Now, if energy was required to get C plus D, it means that you have to provide energy, and that energy is absorbed during the reaction, and it now belongs to C and D. So that means that the energy, I will put the symbol U of C plus D minus U of A plus B, okay, which is energy of products minus energy of reactants, okay, this is greater than 0. If this is greater than 0, the products are at a higher energy than the reactants, and this means that the reaction needed external energy. This is what is normally called as endothermic reaction, and I mean, it is something that everyone is aware of, but it's just that we are emphasizing it again now. And vice versa, if you know energy of products is less than energy of reactants, then this will be an exothermic process. That is because now the energy will be released out, the products are at a lower energy, and normally people show it like this, A plus B is here and either C plus D is here or C plus D is here. So, if you go up, then you require energy and this is endothermic. If you go down, you are throwing out energy, this is exothermic. Now, you realize that all reactions take place at constant pressure. In fact, this is how we maintain, either in a combustion chamber we maintain the pressure constant, or we let things happen in the atmosphere. So, the reaction is at atmospheric pressure and hence the expansion work is inbuilt. So, things are happening at constant pressure and hence what happens is that rather than working with U, everyone works with H. That is because the constant pressure expansion work has to be accounted for and inbuilt into whatever we are using. So, instead of using U, you will see that people will use H. So, H products minus H reactants, okay, is what is called as the delta H of the reaction, okay, or the heat of the reaction in olden days. So, we will call it as the enthalpy of the reaction. So, if delta H r is negative, then you know that the products had a lower energy and this is an exothermic reaction, and delta H r is greater than 0 is an endothermic reaction. So, this is just ensuring that now everyone knows we are working in enthalpy and what the heat of reaction means in this case. So, I will give just an example. We will write, for example, carbon in some graphitic form plus oxygen in gaseous form gives CO2. I am not including here any time now nitrogen or anything. So, the heat of reaction here delta H r is minus 393.5 kilojoule. Okay. So, this means that the products have a lower energy than the reactants and this is an exothermic reaction, and 393.5 kilojoules have come out as a result of 1 mole of carbon burning up with 1 mole of oxygen giving 1 mole of CO2. So, the thing that must now be told is that whenever we are using fuels, okay, fuel plus oxidant better be an exothermic reaction. Otherwise, there is no point in using it as a fuel. We are using something as a fuel only because it will burn and release energy. Okay. If it is going to absorb energy, then it is not a fuel, maybe we are using it for something else. But if something is a fuel, then it better combust or react with the oxidant and release energy. So, carbon, all hydrocarbons react with oxygen and they will release energy, and hence this all these set of compounds are all classified as fuels. So, fuels are anything which will react with the necessary oxidant and release energy. That means, they will undergo an exothermic reaction process. So, that is the key to being called a fuel, otherwise you cannot call it a fuel. So, once this is done, okay, here again I must emphasize that this delta HR is obtained when both these are evaluated at the standard state. Okay, so, you have to get this back at 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C, this is initial, this is also at, okay, or you should get it back to the same temperature, but all tabulation is always done at the standard state, and this delta HR will be given a symbol delta HR naught, that is, this is the heat or enthalpy of reaction at the standard state. If we had carried out the reaction at another temperature, that is, both the reactants and products were at a different temperature, then they are different than 25 degrees C, but they are equal to each other, it would have been the enthalpy of reaction at that temperature, okay, not the standard temperature. But then we will normally never tabulate such values, all tabulated values are always at the standard state, and it is assumed that both the reactants and products are brought down to the standard state, okay. So, whatever enthalpy of reaction is there, this is once the enthalpy of the product is calculated at the standard state. So, once we get this thing straightened out, the other thing that you can tell is that, you know, there is something called as the Hess law or the Hess's law, and this had a reasonable and it made sense to teach this earlier. It just said that if I needed the enthalpy of a particular reaction, or earlier it used to be called the heat of a reaction, okay, if I didn't know or if I couldn't get that reaction in a straightforward manner, I could use other reactions to get the heat of reaction of an unknown reaction. For example, you know, C plus O2, okay, gives CO2, okay. I can burn carbon with oxygen and get carbon dioxide, and you know the heat of reaction for this is easy to obtain. But if I wanted the heat of reaction for C plus O2 giving 2CO, so that means this should be 2 here, the heat of reaction for this is very difficult to calculate. That is because if I try to burn carbon with oxygen and try to obtain CO, it is very difficult even if I try my best to ensure that complete combustion does not occur, because some CO2 forms by default. So, I cannot figure out whether the energy is entirely because of reaction which leads to CO, whereas I can really try to ensure complete combustion. So, CO2 forming is far more easier. So, in this case, we can use the fact, we can use Hess's law as follows: C plus O2, okay, this is bound to be an exothermic reaction, I will go lower here and I will get CO2, okay, and the delta HR, as I said earlier, was 393.5 kilojoule, okay. I need to know this, that is C plus O2, okay, giving, I will put it as C plus O2 giving CO plus half O2. So, I will balance it out like this, because I want to start with the same set of reactants. So, CO is formed, so half O2 is remaining. So, you can think of it in terms of moles, where you say 1 mole of C and 1 mole of oxygen were there. So, 1 mole of CO have formed, you have utilized all the CO and half mole of oxygen is remaining. But as I said, you know, so this is how the reaction is, okay. I say now I have gotten this, I do not know what is the heat of reaction here, but if I ensure the reaction of CO plus half O2, so I get hold of CO and I burn it with oxygen, I will get this CO2. So, I just do this reaction, CO plus half O2, and I will carry out this reaction, and here, since this is now entirely the end product is guaranteed to be CO2, you can easily measure the heat of reaction or the enthalpy of reaction, and it will be 2 minus 283.0 kilojoule. So, now I had to start with 1 mole of C and 1 mole of O2, I could get CO2. If I wanted this, I could not do it directly, but I realized this is enthalpies are just state functions. When I subtract the enthalpy of the reactants from the products, I get my enthalpy of reaction, okay. So, here okay, all I had to, I realize is that, you know, if I went in steps, finally the net enthalpy change should have been the same. So if the enthalpy change here is 283, then the enthalpy change here would only, so the two enthalpy changes here must add up and give this enthalpy change. So here it should be delta HR is equal to -110.5 kilojoules. So this is what, how Hess's law was used. They said that if you could get to a certain set of products in steps, and if you didn't know the heat of reaction, as they called it then, of a particular step, you could use the heat of reactions of other steps plus the heat of reaction of the net reaction to get the heat of reaction of a particular step. So this is what we have done. C plus O2, I can go via two steps or I can go via single step. For the single step, I know the enthalpy of reaction. For the two step reaction, I can get the enthalpy of reaction for one of the steps. So I will be able to get the enthalpy of reaction of the other step. Now, in all this, one must ensure that one is balancing the reaction everywhere, and ensure that you are starting with the same number of moles and ending up with the same number of moles of products, irrespective of the path you take. Okay, so that balancing must be done, and then you can go ahead. So, but then this is, you know, earlier this was thought, oh, this is a very nice method to get it, but I think now probably it should be obvious, because once you know that the enthalpy is a state function, it is a property of those that gas CO plus half O2 at 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C. You know what is the enthalpy here, you know what the enthalpy here is. I know that the difference will directly give me this. I know the difference will directly give me this. So, this addition giving this should be pretty obvious now. And now no longer people use this. People, what they do is they just try to tabulate the enthalpy of formation for each of these species. So that brings us to something called as the enthalpy of formation. So what you do is, I need the enthalpy of every species at the standard state. Okay, and this is what is tabulated. So I need to somehow get this and tabulate this, and this is and in fact you would have, we have uploaded one sheet on the website noting down the enthalpy of a certain set of species. So what here we have to follow some ground rules, and things are standardized here. So the standards that people employ, okay, are, they say that let us start with giving reference enthalpy of 0. Elements occurring in their natural form at standard conditions. Okay. So, if we want to assign enthalpies to all elements, or sorry, all species, we will have to come up with some reference or some standard where we decide that, you know, some guys or some species will have a particular enthalpy at a particular temperature. We need to do this assignment, and then we will find out the enthalpy of other species which are formed from those species. So, the standard or the most reference standard reference that people use is that they assign 0 enthalpy to elements occurring in their natural form at the standard condition. So what does natural form mean? It means that For example, if I am considering a species oxygen, then oxygen occurs as O2 and not as O. So, O2 at 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C is assigned 0 enthalpy. So, you notice that the standards or references used in combustion are much different from, let us say, the references we used in moist air calculation, where we use 0 degree centigrade as the place where we wanted to set 0 enthalpy. But in combustion calculations, okay, all the zeros for naturally occurring elements are set at 25 degrees C, which is considered as the standard state. So, nitrogen occurring again as N2 at these standards is assigned 0. Carbon coming in graphitic form is considered the standard state. So, this is solid at 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C. This is assigned 0, and so on with other species that we will encounter. Okay, so, we are talking only of elements here. So, now if the elements occur in non-standard form, for example, O or N, then we come up with some an enthalpy for these species, but we use a regular reaction to come up with an enthalpy for this. So, for example, I will just now write down I do not have the value here, but let me just tell you that I have oxygen giving 2O. So, let us say that I have obtained this species using standard reactions, and let me see where I have the value for this. Okay, I have the value for, let us say, H2. So, H2 again here as 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C, we will be assigned 0. So, let us say that I need to form from H2, I have to go to twice H, okay, and both of them. So, I now will find out the delta HR for this reaction, and it will turn out that I will need to provide energy to actually get this reaction going, and that is because I need to break the H2 bond and form 2 hydrogen atoms. So, if I have to provide energy, it is an endothermic reaction, and the products will have a higher energy than the reactants, and the delta HR for this reaction turns out to be 436 kilojoule. So, this is a positive number, and what we do now is we say that, okay, you provided 436 kilojoule for 1 mole of hydrogen, but what you actually ended up is getting 2 moles of H. So, we say we assign half the energy to each of these moles of H, and we define something called as the enthalpy of formation for H, or the standard enthalpy for H as 436 by 2 or 218 kilojoule per mole. So, the enthalpy of formation for H is 218 kilojoule per mole. Similarly, you will realize that for oxygen, I will need to provide energy. I will get 2O. Let us say I will need to provide X amount of energy. I do not have the value here right now, but if I provide X amount of energy, then again I get 2 moles of O, and I will assign X by 2 as the enthalpy of formation for oxygen. Okay, and this is all at standard state, because the heat of reaction or the enthalpy of reaction is calculated such that all species are brought back to the standard state, which is 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C. Okay. So, what, and then let me see, for example, if I now go to a compound, let us say I go to H2O, then the enthalpy of reaction, then the enthalpy of formation of the species is defined on the basis of the heat of reaction for forming that species, if from the elements which form the species and which should occur in that standard state. So, for example, H2O is formed from H2 and O2. So, I should consider H2 and O2 in their naturally occurring form at standard state. I should get the reaction which forms H2O, and then I should find out the heat of reaction necessary, and using that I will get the enthalpy of formation for H2O. So, I will write this reaction as such, H2 gas. So, this means 1 mole of H2 plus half mole of oxygen. So, remember I am putting half mole here, we could have always written it as a balanced reaction by saying 2 H2 and 1 O2. But if I write this reaction like this, I get 1 mole of H2O. So, this is all 1 mole, and these are at 1 atmosphere 25 degrees C. So, the elements should occur in their naturally occurring form at the standard state, and if I form the species that is of interest and bring it back to the standard state, and I find delta HR here, okay, the delta HR will turn out to be minus 241.8 kilojoule. That means there is a release of energy. So, now I see that H2O, 1 mole of H2O when it is formed, you know, has to, the heat of reaction is minus 241.8 kilojoule, and since I have now assigned 0 enthalpy at standard state to both H2 and O2, it means that the H of products minus the H of reactants should have given me delta HR. So, now since reactants is 0, H of products is nothing but delta HR, and it is equal to minus 241.8 kilojoule. Okay, and I say that HF for H2O, and I put this dot here to denote standard condition, is minus 241.8 kilojoule per mole. Okay, remember that if I had written the reaction as twice H2 plus O2 giving me twice H2O in a regular balanced form, the delta HR for this reaction would have been twice of this number, and it would have been 483.6 minus. Okay. So, then I would have said 2 moles of H2O will require 483 moles, or you know, this many 483.6 kilojoules are liberated, and you will get the same for 1 mole of H2O. Okay. You will have minus 241.8. So, in this way what we do is, for every species that is of interest to us, we note down HF. So, for example, O2 N2 H2 C in graphite form, okay. These are all assigned 0. Then I will find out what is the enthalpy of formation for H2O, CO2, CO, and any other species of interest. So, for example, if you are doing high temperature calculations, you will realize that nitrogen will react with oxygen to give nitrogen plus oxygen. Let me just write here. I can get all sorts of products, NO2, NO. Okay, N2O. So, when reactions involving these are necessary, you realize all of these are some kind of compounds. Okay, they will not have a 0 enthalpy of reaction at standard state, but they will be formed from nitrogen and oxygen, and we will list HF0 for these species too. Okay, so here we are talking only of relevant species to us. Okay, you will realize that relevant species to us will all be formed from the compounds H, C, N and O, because N and O come from air, and mostly all our fuels are hydrocarbons. Okay, if you are using some other chemistry for some other kind of fuel, then you will require the relevant species there, and you should have a tabulated form for all those species. But this is what is done standardly. Then you realize that you will require HF0 for all the fuels. Okay, so there will be HF0 for CH4. So, CH4 is formed from carbon in graphitic form plus twice H2 will give CH4, and you will realize that there is a delta HR for this, and that delta HR now you assign here to CH4. Similarly, C2H6 and all other species you can think of using CN and HM. It could be alkane, alkene, or it could be any of those alcohols or ketones, etc., which will involve oxygen, but they will be formed from, all of them will be formed from their standard, the elements in their naturally occurring form at the standard state. You find out the heat of reaction for that and accordingly assign the heat of formation for all these species. So, once this tabulation is done, then at standard state, you have H for every species that you are, every species of interest, okay, not every general species, because we are, we will tabulate only for whatever is of interest to every species of interest. So, once this is done, then delta HR for all reactions that we know of can be easily found out. Okay, so if we have a reaction C2H6 plus O2 giving twice CO2 plus 3H2O, and I will just balance it twice O2 and 1.5, so 3.5 O2, I will, at standard state I will get the H of this. The H of this is 0, H of this is tabulated, H of this is tabulated. So, I get the H of the products, I will get the H of the reactants, I will just subtract this and get the H of reaction. And hence, this is how I will proceed to get delta HR for reactions of interest. You will realize that this is delta HR0, which is delta HR at standard state. Now, the one thing that we will realize is, this is at standard state. We need to find out the enthalpy of species at other temperatures. Okay, and this is especially necessary when we need to do calculations regarding adiabatic flame temperatures, etc., because at that time we need to know what kind of temperatures we reach. Okay, so though the heat of reaction is all defined at the standard state, we require H for all species at higher temperatures, and we realize that for every species, as you start providing energy, its enthalpy will start increasing. And for all species, for all elements too, though we started gave 0 at 25°C, okay, so let me just draw it here. Let us say this is temperature, okay, this is 25°, this is H, I have given 0 here, okay. You will realize that as temperature increases, H will increase. And this is what is bound to happen for every species. Let us say I have CO2, CO2 has a negative enthalpy of formation. So, that means at 25°C I start somewhere here, and as I start heating it, its enthalpy will go on increasing like this. And at some point it will cross 0, it does not matter at all where it crosses 0. And this is because we have arbitrarily set the enthalpy of formation to be 0 for certain species at 25°. So, at 25°, certain species have positive enthalpy, some certain species have negative enthalpy, certain species which have negative enthalpy at some higher temperature, they will cross 0. So, this is really of no concern to us, because finally, we will be just interested in the differences in enthalpy to figure out whether we have an exothermic or endothermic reaction and what kind of energy release is there. But if we want to find out how this enthalpy increases, you will realize that if I just write dH is equal to Cp dT, I will need to integrate, I will need, if I know the Cp for every species, then I can get the H for every species as a function of temperature. Now, it turns out that Cp is a function of temperature. So, it is not a constant. In fact, it is going to be a constant only for noble gases. So, all monatomic gases will have Cp constant, but any other species, oxygen, so let me not write oxygen, nitrogen, CO2, H2O, for all of these the Cp itself, if I plot Cp, okay, it will have some shape like this. It will go on increasing with temperature, so it will not be a constant. And we can more or less find this out. So, if we do statistical mechanics, roughly it will turn out that diatomic gases, so for example, monoatomic gases, the Cv would be 3 by 2 and Cp would be 5 by 2, but if I go to diatomic gas, I will have 6 degrees of freedom and Cv will be 3R and Cp will be just 4R, it will always be Cv plus R. So, this is if you, if the entire diatomic gas is at very high temperature, but normally what happens is at room temperature all degrees of freedom have not yet kicked in. So, you will get a certain Cp at lower temperature and as you go higher in temperature, you will attain a certain Cp. For example, for a diatomic gas, I will start somewhere here and then I will plateau out like this. Okay, so, it just between two values, it will vary smoothly. But if I have a triatomic gas, I will have far more degrees of freedom. And every time an extra degree of freedom kicks in till all the degrees of freedom have, you know, have been populated properly, I will keep on varying the Cp till I reach a maximum here. So, this is what happens with all Cp's and they keep on varying as a function of temperature. And what was done was that all these Cp values were tabulated as a function of temperature, or there were polynomial fits which were given to these. Okay, and we will use something which is called as the NASA format. So, a lot of this work was done initially for reactions, and not only that, for reactions of air to form N2, O2, etcetera. You know, whenever not only for burning of fuel, but whenever you know space vehicles re-enter the space, all kinds of reactions regarding nitrogen and oxygen will occur in the atmosphere. And then hence a big database was created for the Cp values of many hydrocarbons as well as many species involving oxygen and nitrogen. And if you go to the NIST website, which is US government website, it is called the National Institute of Standards and Technology, you will get a whole lot of Cp fits. Okay. So, we will use what is called as the NASA format. So, in the NASA format, Cp is a polynomial. With 5 coefficients. So, I will write it as follows. Cp is equal to A0 plus A1t plus A2t squared plus A3t cube plus A4t4. And so, A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, these are 5 coefficients. So, it is, you see, it is a fourth order polynomial with one constant, and usually the temperature has to be input in Kelvin. So, when I put these T's, T as 300, I will get the Cp at 300. If I put T as 1000, I will get the Cp at 1000 and so on. Now, using only a fourth order polynomial, it is not so easy to get the fit in a huge range, and what the range of interest which was of interest, sorry, I mean the temperature range that was of interest was mostly from somewhere between 25 degrees Celsius and going up to some 3000 Kelvin or even up to 5000 Kelvin, because such temperatures could be anticipated. And you will see that most of the fits are given between 300 Kelvin and around 3000 or 4000 Kelvin. And it is not so easy to fit one single fourth order polynomial in this huge temperature range, which is nearly of the order of 4000 Kelvin. So, what they have done is they have fitted two different ranges, and usually they will tell that the ranges are, so 298 Kelvin, which corresponds to 25 degree C, up to 4000 Kelvin is fit, but this is in split in two ranges. So, 298 Kelvin up to, let us say, 1500 Kelvin, and then 1500 Kelvin up to 4000 Kelvin, or some such split. Okay, so it is not always going to be 1500 Kelvin, the split temperature may be 2000 Kelvin, 3000 Kelvin. And in fact, I have given you the sheets and you must download them, because we will use them in the afternoon. And you will see in those sheets, now I am not going to project those sheets, but you will see that I have given sheets for the Cp coefficients, and let us say the coefficient for Co, okay, it is given as Cp upon Ru, this is universal gas constant, so these are all molar specific heats, and it is given as A1, so I have written A0 plus A1 plus A2, so they instead write it as A1 plus A2 T plus A3 T squared plus A4 T cubed plus A pi T 4, and you will see that they have split it between 300 and 1000 is one range, and 1000 Kelvin to 5000 Kelvin is second range, range 2. Okay. So, in fact, for all the species that are given to you in this table, CO, CO2, H2, H2O, N2, the range is 300 to 1000 and 1000 to 5000, but it need not always be like this. If you go to the website, you will find that all kinds of different fits are given. Sometimes it is from 300 to 1500 and then 1500 to 3000. So, whatever is available is given in a certain format, and you will realize that Cp has been, you know, proper values or, you know, well established values of polynomial fits have been provided, and it is a very good source for all our calculations. And if now this is Cp, now if I want H, you require, you realize that we could have just written dH is Cp dT. I can integrate dH, which means I can integrate Cp dT. Now, see, since Cp is a function of temperature, I cannot take it outside the integral, and I will get in their format, it will be written as A1 T squared by 2 plus A2, I think they gave it as A1 plus A2, sorry, I will just. Rub this here, so I will just write it properly. So, if I want this integral of dH is integral of A1 plus A2 T plus A3 T squared plus A4 T cube plus A5 T 4. So, I will get this as A1 T plus A2 T squared by 2 plus A3 T cubed by 3 plus A4 T 4 by 4 plus A5 T 5 by 5. And if I just write it this as H, then you will realize I'll have to put a constant of integration. So, let and they call it as A6, and you will realize that this A6 will be will have to be some function of HF. That is because if I now put T is equal to 298 Kelvin in this, if I put T is 298 Kelvin, so I'll all the values have been put here. So, A6 should be such that once I add up all these values, it should give me H at 298 Kelvin, which is HF0. Okay, so, A6 is in a way it is put in, the constant of integration is put in such a way that once you put 298 Kelvin, you will get the correct H at 298 Kelvin, and it will depend on what the enthalpy of formation of that species is. Okay, so, this is A6. So, you will realize that in the table they have written it in this form, H0 by RT is equal to A1 plus A2 T plus A3 T squared by 3 plus A4 by 4 T square, sorry, T cube plus A5 by 5 T raised to 4 plus A6 by T. So, they have just taken R and T on this side, you just multiply by T and you will see that it is the same form. So, if you want to get H, you first put the T there, calculate the expression and multiply this RU, which will come here, and you will get your H at that particular temperature. Okay. Now, assuming this is an ideal gas, H will be only a function of temperature. Okay. So, in their formula, you will realize that they have put H0, and again it means at standard pressure really, and this is assuming 1 atmosphere pressure, but if the gas behaves as an ideal gas, it is irrespective of pressure, you should still get the same enthalpy. However, S is not so straightforward. So, I will write dS, so or rather I will write TdS is dU plus PdV. So, for any simple compressible substance, I could have written this TdS is dU plus PdV, and of course, this will now be applicable to an ideal gas. And if P is constant, okay, so if P is constant and equal to 1 atmosphere, okay, I can write this as dH. That is because dH should have been dU plus PdV plus VdP, but VdP we are putting as 0 because P is constant. So, TdS is dH, okay, this is assuming this, and dS would be just dH by T, which means it is just Cp dT by T, which means it is just A1 plus A2 T plus A3 T squared plus A4 T cube plus A5, let me just write upon T. dT is there. So, if I integrate this, S would be A1 by T, if I integrate it will be A1 log T plus A2, the T would go when I integrate, again I will get back it. A3 is T squared by 2 plus A4 is T cube by 3 plus A5 is T5 by, T4 by 4. And I will need to add a constant of integration which they call as A7, and you will realize that they have written it in forms of S0 by R. Let me just take a 2-minute break here.